Hi, let's talk about the neurovasculature of the larynx and the pharynx. And let's begin with the pharyngeal plexus, which is a nervous plexus serving the pharynx and the muscles of the soft palate. The pharyngeal plexus gets input from three sources. There are somatic sensory fibers granted from the glossopharyngeal nerve, cranial nerve 10, which we can see here, sharing its posterior association with the stylopharyngeus muscle. The plexus also receives somatic motor fibers from the vagus nerve, which we can see here, which is one of the constituents of the carotid sheath, along with the internal jugular vein and the common carotid artery. The vagus nerve also shares visceral motor fibers or parasympathetic fibers to this plexus as well. And then finally, there are fibers from the superior cervical ganglion of the cervical sympathetic trunk. That trunk isn't visible on the right here, but on the left we can see that superior cervical ganglion there, and there's the remainder of the trunk. We'll also get a better view of the trunk in a subsequent slide. It's probably important to realize that that cervical sympathetic trunk enjoys a posteromedial relationship to the carotid sheath. So it's not within the sheath, but it's found just posterior and medial and a little outside of that sheath. So that's a great place to find that cervical sympathetic trunk. The carotid sheath contents are probably very well viewed here. The carotid sheath itself is a condensation of deep cervical fascia that's going to surround the common carotid artery, the vagus nerve, cranial nerve 10, as well as the internal jugular vein, as well as branches of the vagus nerve. As it ascends higher within the neck, we also have the branches of the common carotid artery, so the internal carotid artery and the external carotid artery, and the proximal portions of those external carotid artery branches sometimes. We also will have the proximal parts of cranial nerve 9, glossopharyngeal, as well as cranial nerve 11, the accessory nerve, because cranial nerves 9, 10, and 11 all leave through the jugular foramina with the internal jugular vein. So the vagus nerve is going to be an important recurring theme throughout our discussions of anatomy in this course. We can see it here. It takes more of a posterior intermediate position within the carotid sheath. And it's going to be a dominant parasympathetic player for elements of the neck, thorax, as well as the abdomen, as we'll see in subsequent videos. The cervical sympathetic trunk is a continuation of the sympathetic trunk, which runs the length of the bony spine. So from the inferior part of the basic cranium of the skull down to the coccyx, which is the distalmost portion of the bony spine within the pelvis, we have these sympathetic trunks on either side. And these trunks consist of ganglia connected by fibers. The ganglia of the neck are condensed. So there's a superior cervical ganglion, which is one of the larger cervical ganglia. And it consists of fused ganglia from the first cervical nerve through the fourth cervical nerve. There's also a middle cervical ganglion, which is variably present. We can see that right here. The middle cervical ganglion consists of fused ganglia of C5 and C6. And then there's an inferior cervical ganglion, which sometimes is going to fuse with the ganglion, the first thoracic ganglia, but it's at least the fused C7 through C8, and oftentimes it includes T1 If that's the case, we refer to it as the cervicothoracic ganglion, also known as the stellate ganglion. We can also see lateral within this image, the internal jugular vein, which is the main vein that drains the brain of blood and also receives tributaries from the face as well, and the common carotid artery. So now let's take a look at some of the branches of the vagus nerve. Here we're looking at an anterolateral view of the neck. There's the thyroid cartilage there. There's the thyroid gland there. Here's the common carotid artery, and there's the internal jugular vein. They've been separated so as to reveal the vagus nerve, which would be deep within the carotid sheath. And it's difficult to visualize this, but coming down, we can see this branch here, highlighting it, and that branch. These are descending down through the carotid sheath, and if we follow these branches, we can see that this branch is the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve, and this branch is the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. Superior laryngeal nerve, you can barely see right there. The internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve is going to be entirely somatic sensory as well as visceromotor to the mucosa superior to the vocal folds. So it will conduct all afferent back from superior to the vocal folds, and it will also be secretomotor to that mucosa as well. The external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve is muscular. It's somatic motor to the cricothyroid muscle. We can also see here recurrent branches of the superior laryngeal nerve, as well as an internal branch. There we see there. That's the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. Here are the recurrent branches. This is the right recurrent laryngeal nerve, and here is the left recurrent laryngeal nerve. These recurrent laryngeal nerves are going to take different courses at the root of the neck. So on the right side, it wraps around the subclavian artery. On the left side, it wraps around the arch of the aorta. So the left recurrent laryngeal nerve is lower down in origin than the right. And then both of them move towards the tracheoesophageal groove, of which they've been dissected out of, to ascend up to the larynx. Some sources will call them the inferior laryngeal nerves when they pass the cricoid cartilage there. But there's no need to do that. We can continue to call them the recurrent laryngeal nerves. These are going to serve all of the intrinsic muscles of the larynx, with the exception of cricothyroid muscle, which is served by the external branch of superior laryngeal nerve. And these will also serve the mucosa inferior to the vocal folds. So they will be somatic sensory, and they will be secretomotor to that mucosa. Now we can see the common carotid artery and its terminal branches, the internal carotid artery and the external carotid artery. That internal carotid artery is going to ascend the remainder of the neck without any branches to the neck, and it's going to enter the skull through the carotid canal of the temporal bone, where it's going to be one of the dominant blood supplies to the cerebro-arterial circle, also known as the circle of Willis. A branch of it will exit the skull as the ophthalmic artery to serve the orbit and the superior brow. The proximal portion of this artery is dilated, And we refer to that as the carotid sinus. And in the walls of the carotid sinus, there are special baroreceptors, or stretch receptors, which can send important autonomic information up to the brain to relate the blood pressure to the brain. So it's a surrogate for if there's adequate blood flow. The external carotid artery is going to have many branches that supply the neck and the face. The first anterior branch here is the superior thyroid artery, which we can see continuing on down to serve the thyroid gland there. The other branch off of that, or I should say the only branch off of that, is the superior laryngeal artery to supply the larynx with blood. Now, the thyroid and the larynx are also supplied by branches of the thyrocervical trunk. If you recall, the thyrocervical trunk is of the first part of the subclavian artery. There's the thyrocervical trunk. And we have an inferior thyroid artery, which serves the thyroid gland and parathyroid glands. And from that, but not visible here, there is an inferior laryngeal artery. But if we come over here, we can see the inferior thyroid artery and the inferior laryngeal artery coming off of that. So when we think about the blood supply to the larynx, there are two laryngeal arteries, a superior and an inferior. The superior is a branch of the superior thyroid artery, which is a branch of external carotid. The inferior is a branch of the inferior thyroid artery, which is a branch of the thyrocervical trunk. Thank you very much for your time.